Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
Greetings, brothers and sisters. We praise Ahaya, Ashri Ahaya, and our Adonai Yache, Meshiaka.
Amen.
And our mother, Ruwacha, Kwadoshi. We hope you all are enjoying the Shabbat today. We are glad for this opportunity to spend with you all. And today, we praise Ahaya, and may it be his will to give edification on Romans 14, and on what Paul is talking about.
Yes.
Look at Hebrews chapter 9, verse 9 to 10, to see a precept, to get an understanding of what the chapter in Romans 14 was about. Hebrews 9, verse 9 and 10.
Hebrews chapter 9, verse 9. Which was a figure of the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices, that could not make him that did the service perfect, as pertaining to the conscience.
We understood that from lessons before. Continue.
Which stood only in meats and drinks.
Meats and drinks, because you had the meat offerings, and then the literal animal sacrifice, physical flesh meat offerings, and drink offerings.
And diverse washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of Reformation.
Yache is the time of that Reformation. And at that time, when the temple was still standing, it was not a transgression to eat the animal sacrifices.
Right.
If you understood that Yache is the true atonement. Because Yache never told anybody to go against that law. Even after he had healed the blind man,
he told him to offer that which Moshe commanded.
Right. So let's go to Romans 14 and 17. We're going to jump there first to see what the dialogue was about.
Romans chapter 14, verse 17. For the kingdom of Elohim is not meat and drink.
Just like it was talked about in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 10. Now we know what Paul was discussing with them in the whole chapter by what he said toward the end of the chapter. Continue.
But righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit.
And we know Yache is our righteousness. That's why in the Old Testament it says one of his names shall be Ahaya, our righteousness.
Right.
Hence, Paul told him, the kingdom of Elohim is not in meat and drink. So it didn't make a difference if you eat the animal sacrifices that were being done at Jerusalem or not. But righteousness, that's right. What actually makes a difference. Because right. You actually have to be a living sacrifice in peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. That's the true kingdom of Elohim that comes from within us in our hearts.
That's right.
Now to understand Romans 14, we have to understand the environment. They were still doing animal sacrifices at Jerusalem in the days of the apostles because the temple was still there until Rome destroyed it under Titus and Vespasian. Let's look at Acts chapter 21, verse 23 to 24.
Acts chapter 21, verse 23. Do therefore this that we say to thee.
Now, this is when Paul came to Jerusalem. He got to meet with James and the apostles and the elders there, and the people from the other areas outside of Jerusalem were saying that he was teaching everybody not to keep the law of Moses.
Right.
The people didn't understand it, hence they thought Paul telling people don't do the laws of animal sacrifices.
Right.
But we're going to see here that Paul also kept the laws as well. To give clarification, the problem people were having was they were thinking they wouldn't be saved if they didn't do the animal sacrifices.
Or partake in it.
Right, and that was what Paul was giving the edification on. This Yache sacrifice is the salvation, not the carnal animal sacrifices. That's why the kingdom of Elohim is not in meat and drink, but it's in righteousness, which is in Yache. Let's continue, please.
We have four men which have a vow on them. Them take and purify thyself with them and be at charges with them.
Because there's requirements that comes with the purification of the Nazarites. And we're going to look at that. Continue.
That they may shave their heads.
That's what confirms to let you know it was a Nazarite vow. Continue.
And all may know that those things whereof they were informed concerning thee are nothing, but that thou thyself also walketh orderly and keepest the law.
That law right there was talking about the sacrifices as well, because Paul said he lived his manner of life without offense to Elohim or men.
That's right.
He said concerning the law, he's a Pharisee. He was devout about everything. Let's look at what that Nazarite vow is in Numbers chapter 6, verse 13 to 21.
Numbers chapter 6, verse 13. And this is the law of the Nazarite. When the days of his separation are fulfilled, he shall be brought unto the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and he shall offer his offering unto Ahaya, one he lamb of the first year without blemish.
So he had to go to the tabernacle.
One he lamb of the first year without blemish for a burnt offering, and one ewe lamb of the first year without blemish for a sin offering, and one ram without blemish for peace offerings, and a basket of unleavened bread cakes of fine flour mingled with oil, and wafers of unleavened bread anointed with oil, and their meat offering and their drink offerings. And the priest shall bring them before Ahiah, and shall offer his sin offering and his burnt offering. And he shall offer the ram for a sacrifice of peace offerings unto Ahiah, and the basket of unleavened bread. And the priest shall offer also his meat offering and his drink offering. And the Nazarite shall shave the head of his separation at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation.
That's the purification they were telling Paul about, to shave his head and be purified.
And put it in the fire which is under the sacrifice of the peace offerings. And the priest shall take the sodden shoulder of the ram and 1 unleavened cake out of the basket and 1 unleavened wafer, and shall put them upon the hands of the Nazarite after the hair of his separation is shaven. And the priest shall wave them for a wave offering before Ahiah. This is holy for the priest, and the wave breast and heave shoulder. And after that, the Nazarite may drink wine. This is the law of the Nazarite who hath vowed.
That's why he said we have four men to have
on their heads.
Right. Continue.
And of his offering unto Ahiah for his separation, besides that, that his hand shall get, according to the vow which he vowed, so he must do after the law of his separation.
Paul was not in offense to any law. So you see why they told Paul to go ahead and do the Nazarite vow with these guys, so they can see that all the stuff that they're saying is nothing,
not true.
That you actually walk in order and keep the law. Let's go back to Acts chapter 21, verse 25. We see how through the law we get understanding of what was going on in the New Testament.
That's right.
Continue.
As touching the Gentiles which believe, we have written and concluded that they observe no such thing.
Gentiles do not do Nazarite vows, because that's the law of the Israelites. Ahiah, be gracious. May he give us an opportunity to go into the actual laws of the Gentiles at another time. All right?
Save only that they keep themselves from things offered to idols, and from blood, and from strangled, and from fornication. Then Paul took the men, and the next day, purifying himself with them, entered into the temple to signify the accomplishment of the days of purification.
So you see, he went up, they shaved their head, hey, we're done, we're here, we're at the temple, continue.
Until that an offering should be offered for every one of them.
And now they had to wait for the priest. These are actual sacrifices. So we see Paul actually did the sacrifices. This is to understand, again, what the environment was when Paul was writing to the Romans. Acts chapter 24, verse 16 to 18, please.
Acts chapter 24, verse 16. And herein do I exercise myself.
This is Paul speaking.
To have always a conscience void of offense toward Elohim and toward men.
He was teaching people, do not think your salvation lies in the animal sacrifice. Don't think that's what justifies you.
That's right.
Because by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified.
That's right.
It's by faith in Yache's blood that actually justifies us, to purge our conscience. As he also spoke with the Hebrews in chapter 9, that those things could not purge our conscience, as we discussed many times before. Right. All right, let's continue.
Now, after many years, I came to bring alms to my nation and offerings.
So he came with alms to his nation, which was the collection of the saints that he went and got.
Right.
And he came with an offering. So he came to do animal sacrifice as well, because he was still devout in everything toward Elohim.
Whereupon certain Jews from Asia found me purified in the temple, neither with multitude nor with tumult.
Now you can understand that while the temple is still standing, they were doing animal sacrifice, because it's the law of the Jews. We can also look and see that even though the temple was still standing at that time, one didn't have to do animal sacrifice, because we have Yache as our sacrifice in truth. Because Paul also had a vow before, but didn't go to the temple to offer sacrifices. So we can see that he did it to silence the people that were spreading heresies about him, even though he knew Yache was the sacrifice, even as we are taught today. Let's look at Acts 18 and 18.
And Paul after this tarried there yet a good while, and then took his leave of the brethren, and sailed thence to Syria, and with him Priscilla and Aquila, having shorn his head in Caesarea, for he had a vow.
So we see that he had a Nazarite vow at another time, but he didn't go to the temple because he knew Yache is the true sacrifice. So we can see how at that time, you didn't actually have to partake in the sacrifices.
Right.
The Israelites that believed were zealous of the law of Moses' animal sacrifices as well in those days. Because it wasn't just Paul. Acts 15 and 5, they were Pharisees and they believed in Yache too.
But there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moshe.
And that was in their zeal, right? But they had a full discussion in chapter 15 to understand we don't need to put that pressure on the brothers of Israel that are coming in and not knowing these things, because they are being saved by faith, even as we are through Yache.
Right.
And you don't put that pressure on the Gentiles because it's not their law to keep. Romans 14 goes into the meat and drink sacrifices at Jerusalem in the times of the apostles. The people were coming to Jerusalem for the feast as well in those days. And we can look and see that they literally will come to Jerusalem in Acts chapter 2, verse 1, verse 5, and verse 10, please.
I want to clarify on the circumcision.
Okay.
Just to make it clear. Paul was teaching the people that came into the faith not to circumcise themselves because they came in by faith.
Yes.
Right? But yes. He wasn't telling them not to circumcise their children.
Right? That's right.
Right. And also for the Gentiles, you wouldn't circumcise yourself if you came in by faith.
Thank you for that clarification as well.
Acts chapter 2, verse 1.
Verse 1, verse 5, and
verse 10. All right. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. And when the days of Pentecost were fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. This is verse 5. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men out of every nation under heaven.
Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, parts of Libya.
About Cyrene, and strangers of Rome, now, Jews and proselytes.
It gives good understanding of the environment to understand the letters as well.
That's right.
So let's jump into Romans 14.
All right.
Romans 14, verse
1.
All right.
Him that is weak in the faith, receive ye, but not to doubtful disputations. For one believeth that he may eat all things, another who is weak eateth herbs.
So you see, one believeth there's nothing wrong with eating the things that were provided by Elohim that are according to his law, whereas another, they don't want to mess with it. They think it's all Elohim's creation, right. Let's leave it alone.
Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not, and let not him which eateth not judge him that eateth. For Elohim hath received him.
So the meat eater can't look down upon the vegetarian,
right.
Nor can the vegetarian look on the meat eater as if he is not in the faith for eating the sacrifices,
right.
Because Elohim has received him. There will be people who believe that still ate the sacrifices, like we read in Acts 15 and 5 and
right.
Paul himself, and there were people that believe and don't eat the sacrifices, just as even Paul showed the dichotomy with his Nazarite vow, when he had it and went to the temple, as opposed when he was out somewhere else and didn't worry about going to the temple.
Right.
Okay, let's continue. Romans 14 and 4.
Who art thou that judgeth another man's servant? To his own master he standeth or falleth. Yea, he shall be holding up, for Elohim is able to make him stand.
The vegetarian can't judge the meat eater as a sinner because he ate the sacrifices, because he's not his master. And it's lawful. He didn't transgress the law by eating the sacrifices because he actually believed in Yache's blood while he was eating it. Both of them alike have Yache's master, the one that eats the sacrifices and the one that just eats herbs. And he is the one who judges whether either one of them is in the faith or not, because the true sacrifice is to partake in Yache. He judges to see if they are living sacrifices, whether they eat the sacrifices or not.
Right.
Let's continue.
One man esteemeth one day above another. Another esteemeth every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind.
Now, this is interesting because one man esteems certain feast days while another man esteems every feast day alike.
Right.
Each shall do what seems righteous unto a donor in their mind.
I'll continue verse 6. He that regardeth the day regardeth it unto a donor.
See?
And he that regardeth not the day, to a donor he doeth not regard it.
So the ones that eats is to a donor. The one that doesn't eat is to a donor.
He that eateth to a donor, but he giveth Elohim thanks. And he that eateth not, to the donor he eateth not, and giveth Elohim thanks.
One man esteems the feast and eats the sacrifices at Jerusalem that pertain to it in faith to Yache, while the other man in faith to Yache didn't eat the sacrifice. Both are doing it in reverence to a donor and thanks to Elohim. Continue.
For none of us liveth to himself, and no man dieth to himself.
So we see Paul is still exhorting each man has to live unto Yache, live unto Alahayim. We all have to be living sacrifices. Continue.
For whether we live unto Adonai. We die unto the Adonai. Whether we live, therefore, or die, we are Adonai.
So in their time, it meant whether you eat the sacrifice or not, it is unto Adonai. And we still live as sacrifices to Adonai either way. For us today, whether vegetarian or meat eater, we do it unto Adonai and we live for Adonai by being living sacrifices either way. All right, continue.
For to this end, Messiah both died and rose and revived, that he might be Adonai both of the dead and living. Let us not therefore judge one another any more, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way.
And we see, he said, let us not judge each other any more. You can use Colossians chapter 2, verse 17, where he says, let none judge you in respect of a holy day, Sabbath, right, or feast days, or new moons, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Messiah. So there's no condemning people, even at that time, if they didn't partake in animal sacrifices. Right, right. Easy to grasp what Paul was teaching the people. And that's why we have to all do what is righteous in the sight of Elohim and be mindful not to set a stumbling block or occasion to fall in a brother's way.
That's right.
He's exhorting the people to judge according to righteousness, judge according to what is unto edification. Knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifies. So we must not judge each other as wrong for being vegetarians or meat eaters, just as they couldn't judge each other for eating the sacrifices or not, because we both are servants of the same master, Yache, and we both are partaking in the spiritual meat of the body of Yache. As 1 Corinthians 10, verse 3 and 4 tells of, and Corinthians 11, verse 23-27, about their communion. Now, this is great exhortation for us to understand how we ought to operate amongst each other this day. Be mindful not to set a stumbling stone before our brothers and sisters.
Right.
And then this dialogue, he's going to show that he's referencing for the meat eater not to force the vegetarian to eat meat when they don't eat it. That's for our time, even. If somebody doesn't eat meat, we don't put the pressure on them because they're doing it unto Yache.
Right.
Let's continue. Romans 14 and 14.
I know and am persuaded by the Adonai Yache that there is nothing unclean of itself, but to him that esteemeth anything to be unclean, to him it is unclean.
Now, Paul knows the law.
That's right.
And he does everything with void of offense to Elohim. He said, I know there's nothing unclean of itself because everything Elohim said is clean, is clean. But to him that sees it as such, is that's how he sees it. Now, Paul is referencing the vegetarian who doesn't eat it. Right. Hence, he sees it as unclean. And we know Paul spoke to them that knew the law. As in 1 Corinthians 15 and 34, so he was saying that no clean animal is unclean of itself because Elohim already established what was clean and unclean from the beginning, since Noah knew the difference between clean and unclean animals in Genesis 7 and 2. So he was showing in regards to a vegetarian who could only see meat as unclean if he just didn't feel it was right to do. So get understanding that. The meat was not actually unclean to Elohim, so it didn't hinder the meat eater from eating it. So it wasn't any justification to eat unclean food. That's not what Paul was saying. Verse 15.
But if thy brother be grieved with thy meat, now walketh thou not charitably.
But if you're putting that pressure on that man that eats meat, now you're not walking charitably. Because charity looketh not after its own. Continue.
Destroy not him with thy meat, for whom Messiah could die.
And that's why Paul said in the first verse of Romans 14, not for doubtful disputations. Because
right,
you're putting pressure on him, you're making him doubt his faith in Yache. Because for him, he was persuaded that he's not eating those animal sacrifices because he believes in Yache. Continue.
Let not then your good be evil spoken of.
One might think they're doing good by compelling the vegetarian to eat, but in truth, it's not good because you're causing him to waver in the faith that he had already set his mind to.
All right. Give him a modern day example, like Passover day, right?
Mm-hmm.
We take a piece of meat, we cook it, and then we eat it at the memorial to Yache.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Now, if somebody's a vegetarian, we wouldn't tell them, hey, you got to eat this to partake in Yache.
Right. We would tell them, eat that communion.
Eat that bread and that wine.
We'll continue. Verse 17.
For the kingdom of Elohim is not meat and drink.
That's what we can tell them. It's not meat and drink.
But righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit.
So we also tell them, make sure you're being a living sacrifice. As the Yache said in Luke 17 and 21, the kingdom of Elohim is within you. His kingdom is spiritual and his sacrifices are spiritual according to the law of the Spirit of life. As Romans chapter 8 verse 2 and 1 Peter 2 and 5 talks about. Not the carnal law of eating meat and drink offerings after the flesh. As Hebrews 9 and 10 showed, the true meat and drink is, as Yache said in John 6, 53 to 58, is actually that communion. Hence, no man can judge the body of Mashiach because it doesn't eat the meat and drink offerings at Jerusalem, because the body operates in the fruits of the spirit of righteousness, peace, and joy. Continue verse 18.
For he that in these things serveth Mashiach is acceptable to Elohim.
That's right. That's how we get accepted. Right. By being living sacrifices. By walking in the kingdom of Elohim according to righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Working all the fruits of the Holy Spirit.
And approved of men.
Because we'll be at peace with all men, as Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14 mentions. So that's how we know we're walking in the right path. We're in the kingdom of Elohim and being lights in the world because we're going to be at peace with all in righteousness. Verse 19.
Let us therefore follow after the things which make for peace and things wherewith one may edify another.
So there we see, as he was showing, he told him, now walkest thou not charitably if right. you're forcing it upon your brother.
That's right.
And he went in the next few verses to exhort to understand how to actually walk charitably and what the kingdom is really about.
For meat destroy not the work of Elohim. All things indeed are pure, but it is evil for that man who eateth with offense.
So you can eat the animal sacrifices, right. and you can eat the clean meat that's been appointed as clean, but it's a transgression.
Right.
If you're offending somebody
right.
in the faith of Yache, it's because you're setting a stumbling block before the brother. What would be an offense off of the example you gave earlier? The person, they don't eat meat because they know Yache is a sacrifice and we're pressuring them. Like, you got to eat a piece of meat. You right. got to eat a piece of meat. That's causing them to stumble, to lose their faith, to start trusting in, well, I got to do the sacrifices.
Right.
That's not the right direction. That's not onto charity. That's not edifying. All right. Continue.
It is good neither to eat flesh, nor to drink wine, nor anything whereby thy brother stumbleth, or is offended, or is made weak. Hast thou faith? Have it to thyself before Elohim. Happy is he that condemneth not himself in that thing which he allowed.
Happy is he that keeps himself and doesn't be given over to the things that he knows he can do for the sake of the person that's there.
All things are lawful for me, but not expedient.
Right.
That's right.
We have to do things for the good of others. We are judged for other men's consciences,
right?
Because we have to be able to stand before Elohim and say that we did all things pleasing in his sight unto all men. Continue.
And he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of faith.
We see how the vegetarians would be in trouble because he had made the choice not to eat the meat unto a dunno and let someone deter him from the choice he made unto a dunno and break his word that he had his mind made up to do. The meat eater caused him to doubt his faith and think that if he didn't eat the sacrifices, he wasn't in the faith, which turns a vegetarian from the truth of the gospel, which is that it is by the offering of Yache we have salvation, not by the animal sacrifices, as Paul talked about in Galatians chapter 2, verse 16 and 17.
Right.
By the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. So if one is a vegetarian, there is a difference than one that eats meat. Now, this is talking about that was then and also today. You don't have to eat meat for any feast. Now, it's interesting. We don't have to do the sacrifices now. We have to be the living sacrifices right now.
That's right.
And in the time to come in the kingdom, the animal sacrifices are actually going to be reestablished under Yache because he's Melchizedek.
Right.
And the Gentiles are going to be there too. So it's a wonderful time to come. We look at some of the scriptures about that. Malachi 3, verse 3 and 4.
Malachi chapter 3, verse 3. And he shall sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver. He shall purify the sons of Lawaye and purge them as gold and silver. that they may offer unto Ahayah an offering in righteousness.
That's quite amazing. As gold is tried in a furnace, so acceptable men in the furnace of adversity. So you see how the sons of Levi are going to begin purged to make them living sacrifices in this earth so that they could be prepared for to do the actual sacrifices of righteousness in the kingdom.
That's right.
Continue.
Then shall the offering of Judah on Jerusalem be pleasant unto Ahayah, as in the days of old, and as in former years.
Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 18 to 22.
Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 18. Neither shall the priests of the Levites want a man before me to offer burnt offerings, and to kindle meat offerings, and to do sacrifice continually. And the word of Ahayah came unto Jeremiah, saying, Thus saith Ahayah, if ye can break my covenant of the day and my covenant of the night, and that there should not be day and night in their season, then may also my covenant be broken with the way that my servant, that he should not have a son to reign upon his throne, and with the Levites, the priests, my ministers.
There will be priests, Levites, ministering in his kingdom. The Gentiles are going to be there too. Let's look at Isaiah chapter 56, verse 6 to 8.
Isaiah 56, verse 6. Also the sons of the stranger that join themselves unto Ahayah to serve him, and to love the name of Ahayah, to be his servants, everyone that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it, and taketh hold of my covenant. Even them will I bring to my holy mountain, and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon mine altar, for mine house shall be called an house of prayer for all people. Adonai Ahayah, which gathereth the outcast of Israel, saith.
He's gathering his remnant, and what else is he doing?
Yet will I gather others to him, beside those that are gathered unto him.
Gentiles going to be there too. Praise Ahayah. So that's what Paul was talking about in Romans 14.
All right. Good.
Chala.
Chala.